Yes. Before going further, I want to do a little computation that I will need later. You see, I told you about this orthogonality of complementarity of the Jacobian downstairs with the prime. But also they are orthogonal with respect to the polarization. For instance, at the level of the tangent planes, the tangent spaces, and the zero, one is orthogonal to the other. So the tangent space to the Jacobian of C is orthogonal to the tangent to the prime with respect to the polarization, to this bilinear form. So by construction, let's put this as a remark. By construction, the tangent at zero of C tilde is the space of holomorphic differentials of C tilde. Yeah, because it's a quotient. Jacobian is a quotient of this space. Actually, it should be dual. So the tangent space. And you have also an action of the involution, iota, into this space. So that give you two split as a representation in the invariant part, as I said, plus. Where acts by plus and plus one, and then where the involution acts with minus one, minus. Okay, so the plus one is isomorphic to the tangent, so to the tangent space to the Jacobian downstairs. So C omega C. Okay, so I should be dual also. Okay, and the other is this will be the tangent to the prime. Okay, well, more precisely, if you apply the projection formula, so let's see, this is take C tilde omega C tilde. That is isomorphic to the A0. You push forward the curve. So you have C downstairs, push forward of this diamond. Okay. But actually you can write this bundle. You can also tensor over the trivial one and nothing changes. But on the other hand, for a tile coverings, for ramified tile coverings, you know, this is also Riemann-Hurwitz, you know that the pullback of omega C is isomorphic of omega C tilde. This is because it's a tile, you don't have ramifications. So so actually this is, let me write this. C tilde, and then here you apply the projection formula that tells you that this line bundle is equals omega C tensor push forward of the trivial bundle. But the push forward of the trivial bundle is given, you see, is given by this line bundle that we construct. C omega C tensor. C tensor eta. Okay. So that's just moment. This is plus direct sum. And well, this is distributive, and A0 of the direct sum of line bundles is it also is the sum of the A0. So you get A0 of C omega C. Direct sum OC tensor, yes, eta. Okay, So you have the two parts, the decomposition. And this is precisely the decomposition I was talking about. So this part is precisely the tangent to P. Dual. Well, it has to be dual because, yes.
Maybe this is yes. Omega C.
Yeah, it's omega C.
Tensor eta.
Right? Omega C, thank you. Yes. Uh-huh. Okay. Omega C. Mm-hmm. So this is what let's just to put it the historical context. This is what the Prim, the Mr. Prim, Friedrich Prim, he was an analyst. Analyst. He didn't know anything about coverings or so. But he studied what he studied. It was this Prim differential. So later, Mumford called it the Prim differentials. So the Prim differentials are the sections of this line bundle. Mm-hmm. And this is what how Friedrich Prim was studying at the time as an analyst. This is I'm talking about 19th century. Okay, now this was a little remark. So you know also the tangent to the prim. So let me define the prim map. So the prim map, so this is classical prim map, there will be more prim maps later, is PG from RG. The tallow coverings into AG minus one. I never said the dimension, right? Okay, I will make a remark. So you take a class of a tallow covering or equivalent a curve plus a two torsion point, and you associate the prim with the principal polarization. Okay. So observe, so maybe I can put it here. So in this case, the dimension of the prim, G tilde minus G, and by Hurwitz formula, this is 2G minus one minus G, so it's G minus one. So this is why you get G minus one, okay? So that's very nice. We have a global wave to room growing down, again, a curve plus an extra data, the two torsion points, and you get a principal polarized abelian variety. Let's come back to my table. Where's my table? This table, here. In this table, now with the prim map, you get from MG to AG minus one. So this is dimension of AG. So you go from one up. So the prim map, for instance, go from here. This is P4. From here to here, this is P5. And from here to here is P6. Okay. So just comparing dimensions, we expect that now the general principally polarized abelian variety of dimensions, at most five are prims of some double coverings, total double coverings, just because of the dimension. Of course, you need some theorem to tell that. So let me write it, summarize the theorem. So this is a big theorem. So, so the prim map is dominant if genus is at most six. And this was already known by Wirtinger, also German mathematicians from end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century. And that was already studied. And then PG is known, is generically finite. Mm-hmm. Yeah, not only finite, generically injective. If the genus is at least seven. So just look at the dimension, it's where you have room to put RG inside of AG minus one. And in those cases, as soon as the dimensions allow it, you get generically injective. And which is more striking is that the pre-map is never injective. So it will be always some loci inside of AG where the pre-map is not, is never injective. That was first noticed by Beauville, but then it's more generally stated by the, if we have time in the course, I would like to talk about tetragonal's construction of Bunaki. Oops, let's put it properly. So this is Donaghi's tetragonal construction. So over the curve C, where the C is tetragonal, the pre-map is not going to be injected. And you have so, such loci in any genus. Of course, higher is the genus, this loci is small, smaller construction. And I should put some names because let's see. I think the first one to show the generic injectivity, I want to put some names because it's a work of many years, many mathematicians. I think the first one to prove it was Friedman and Schmidt. For some, it's not one of the genus, I think genus at least 16. And then for genus at least 8, Kanev did it. And then, and those are by the generation methods. It was very much by the generation. And then Welters have another proof. And the last proof I know is De Waal has another proof. And those are more in a more geometric one, as in the Torelli and the Torelli map, in Torelli. So those are the names. So you have many papers related to this. That's right. Here's a open question that I think Pavel already mentioned. Still open. What is exactly the non-injectivity locus of the prima? Describe completely the non-injectivity locus. So although the theorem is a little bit now classical, this is from the 80s, or we don't know the answer to this question. okay, let's see. So how do you prove that something is generically injective, for instance? And then we'll be interested in this question. You have to look at the codifferential of the pre-map. And so to show that something is generically injective, you need to show that the differential of the pre-map is injective, is generically finite, so, or equivalent that the codifferential is subjective. So let me write it down. To show that PG is, first of all, generically finite, one has to show that the differential of the pre-map is injective or equivalent, the codifferential, so the dual of PG, that goes from the cotangent space of AG minus one into the cotangent space of RG is surjective at the generic point. And is it better to look at the codifferential because we have a nice description of these cotangent spaces. So let's see. We use the following identifications. So let's put an element in the image. P is the image of C eta. So something in the print. So this is in AG minus one. We have the identifications. Identification So one side, you see the tangent, the cotangent at the point C eta of RG. And I'm using the fact that RG is finite to 1 to MG by this forgetful map. So at the level of cotangent, you put yourself in one point, you can identify the tangent plane to the tangent plane of the image. It's just generically, it's just finite. So this is the cotangent at the point C of MG. And this is also well known, is the space of quadratic differentials on C. Okay, I am keeping a lot of theory here behind. I just want to apply to my map. On the other hand, the cotangent space to P of HEY minus one is the symmetric product of the tangent space to P, the dual of the tangent space to P, that I just compute is the symmetric product of A zero of C of the prime differentials. In such a way that the codifferential map, when you use these identifications at this generic point, at the generic point, is just the most natural thing to do. You have the symmetric product of these two. So you have two sections of the prime differentials, and you go to H zero of C omega C, well, just multiply them. It's given by the multiplication of sections. So in principle, this multiplication of sections, you go to, you multiply them, and you'll end up in this omega C square tensor eta square. So the multiplication of two sections here is a section of this line bundle. But then you identify these two spaces because eta square is trivial. Okay. So this is the codifferential map. And the question is when this map is surjective. When is it surjective? And it turns out it's gonna be surjective as soon as the dimension allows it, but as soon as the dimension of the left side is bigger than the other. And that's how you get the theorem. So let's just write it down. Lemma. And it's not that difficult. The codifferential is surjective for genus of the six. Okay, good. Now, this works for any G. Okay, you have a full theory, and for the course, I want to concentrate in the beautiful case. Look at this. This case. When both dimensions, this dimension is the same as this dimension, okay? It's the only case for double curves where it happens. We know in this case, the map is generically finite because it's also dominant. So same dimension, that means it's generically finite. And we want to compute the degree. And this little question of what is the degree of this map leads us to a worth of geometry really opens the door to all possible classical geometry. And this is what I'm interested in to show you in this course. So let's concentrate to the case P6 from R6 to A5. Okay, so let me tell you right away the theorem. This is proven in the paper of Donaghy Smith, which is also on the website, P6, R6 to A5. Well, I know it's generically finite. of degree 27. Okay. And I'm not gonna get to, yeah, maybe everybody knows what this 10 is 27 means, but I'm not gonna tell you right now. I'm just gonna go as the authors did it. Okay, let's do it step by step. So what is the plan? To prove that is that first we had to extend PG to some partial compactifications. So PG extends to a proper map. So to compute a degree, you need to have a proper map, essentially. And if to get a proper map, you have to allow more more double covering on the boundary. And this is the part which is more difficult, but in some sense beautiful when you allow things on the boundary. So once you have that, you extend the prim map to, you have to extend, so this is also a long work, extend the prim map to the boundary. So the boundary is what we will call allowable double coverings. And essentially that will be now coverings between stable curves, but not any stable curve, but we'll say which ones. And one has to study the generalized. So you have also a theta divisor. So I have to study the generalized theta divisor. And then you compute also the local degree along different loci on a special file or a particular file. Yes, I had to tell you. They do all the construction over one file. Okay. Good. Okay, now is where the course starts to be a little bit more technical, complicated. I will try to give you the main ideas. This is the plan. I think at first I have to tell you what a stable curve is. So stable curves, they were invented to compactify the modular space MG. It was not compact. So we say that a curve C is stable, it could be smooth, yeah? Is smooth, or it is connected, I don't want this connected, and the only singularities are nodes, are ordinary double points. And the automorphism group is finite. And the automorphism group of C is finite. So for instance, you have for all rational components, they must have three marked points to make, because if you don't mark the point, you have finitely infinitely many automorphisms of this rational curve. So either have a node or meet in other components and three points. Okay. Mm-hmm. That's right. So this leads us to some modular space, a compactification of MG. This is the modular space of stable curves. Stable curves of genus C. Let me. Let me do the following assumption. So this is how Bobil started, but I think it's, I want to do this little computation because, yeah, I mean, to do something, prove something, yeah, so let's do something. You have a C tilde stable curve, yes, with an involution, with iota involution. And assume the following condition. This is Bobil's conditions, that the fixed points of C under this involution are exactly the singularities. The singular points. And that a singular point so you have a singular point, the two branches are not exchanged. Change it on there. That was the first conditions to work with. So why? So under this condition, you have the following situation: that the quotient by the iota has only ordinary double points, as singularities. Okay, so that means equal C. C tilde iota. So I get again an unstable curve in G bar. And the proof is a local computation of the nodes. I don't know, let me say if you can do it, or I leave it for the exercises. Yes. Let's do it. Proof. So take a singular point S in C tilde, singular, which is fixed by the involution iota. Okay. So the completion ring, at this point, locally is isomorphic. Or can one identify to the formal power series in two variables, call it UP modulo the ideal U times V. So essentially, then is the drop. You have a singularity like this, and in one branch is to have the U, and the other branch is V. The U equals zero, V equals zero. Okay, this is how it looks locally. And okay, you have two possibilities. If iota exchange the branches, that means that one can choose, this U and V. So how does he act the iota in these parameters? In U is V, and in V is U. So I think the drawing is, so you just exchange iota. So this goes to this. Okay, this is clear. But then the subring of invariance is invariance under iota of this completion ring is the formal power series. So C is the sum U plus V. This is the supring, which means that so the invariance under E is that gives you the local description under the quotient. So this is what will happen when you go to the quotient. So essentially, if this happens, the quotient is smooth. Okay, this is a smooth ring. This is a regular ring, which is regular. Okay. If it changes, the branches of S, so the you can choose these local parameters as minus U. Doesn't exchange, sorry. Does not exchange the branches. So it acts in this way. Okay. And then the subring of invariance, under iota of this completion ring is given by the power series V4. Yes, because you are identifying iota with the this is for those when it doesn't, the minus doesn't matter, modulo that's all. And then but this subring can be identified to the ring, also formal power series in two variables, but now modulo x, the product x epsilon. And that means that we have a node on the quotient. So let's do the, so I draw a picture like this in this case. So this is the fixed point. Iota doesn't exchange the branches. So you get a node. Downstairs, you get a node. Okay. So what I want is that, okay, this is my little computation. I think this is the most complicated computation I'm gonna do today, but I just want to explain the importance of these exchanging branches or not extending branches. So this this condition allows you to go nodes goes to nodes. Okay, and this is what they want. Okay. Mm-hmm. I have to do some choices now. Okay, maybe I could jump some. I want to give you the definition of allowable coverings. What is my definition? Moment. Not yet. Huh? I have to work on the. Yes. Okay. Let's do. I think it's all interesting anyway. So independent of the purpose. So assume that we are in this condition. Assume the condition asterisk. So the quotient has only the ordinary double points. Only nodes, let's put shortly. And you have a commutative diagram like this. So you have to go through the normalization of your curves. So this is pi. That's called, let's call F. F is the normalization of the normalization map from C. And then so you have a map, let's call pi prime, on the, at the lower. The level of the normalization. So, as a little lemma under these conditions, the push forward it behaves a little bit like a Natal case, because the push forward of C, even if it's not, this is a stable curve, is still the canonical divisor on C tilde. I'm cheating a little bit because we have to work it out. So you see that the issue here. I am now on the boundary, my curves are stable, I have nodes, okay, nothing else, nodes, and we have to make it, get an idea, a clear idea, what does it mean to have line bundles on these stable curves? And so what does it mean, the shifts? Well, I will give you this idea. First, just to let me tell you something, that the arithmetic, because of this lemma, the arithmetic genus, now we have to talk about the arithmetic genus, still has this property. This is twice the arithmetic genus of C minus one, okay? It still holds. So you have this relation. Now, I have to tell you what are the Cartier divisors, just to get an idea of what they're on C tilde. And then we'll give some examples as well, okay? Very simple one. So don't worry if it looks too technical. Let's call K tilde. So that will be the ring of functions on C tilde, K, the ring of functions on C, yes? So if C tilde has several components, those will be the product of the field of functions of the component. So you have, and then I have to define the group of Cartier divisors on C is, yes? So you can think of a shift of ring of functions, So when the curve is connected, you have a field of functions associated to the curve. And here, since I have several components, I cannot talk about a field, but they can think about a ring. So just take the product of these fields on each component. Yes, you can think of yes. I don't hear well. Yes, more or less.
It's all clear.
Okay.
Okay.
So the group maybe are more familiar with Cartier divisors. So the group of the Cartier divisors of this curve, so is tip C tilde. So you have a part coming from the, as we see, the divisors, normal divisors. So on the smooth part, so the formal sums of points where x is on the regular part, plus something coming from the nodes, from the singularities. Okay, and then okay, and they have to. So you have this ring of functions. So you have at the is the fiber modulo. OS, okay. I mean, it's all local, yeah? It's C tilde and the point S, okay? So let me see what happens. So you have the normalization. The normalization assumes that you have these two points. These two points under the normalization map get identified in one node, C tilde. So this is C1, C2. And let's call nu1 and nu2 the valuations of these points. So the valuation at the point is the function that tells you you have a pole or a zero of a function there. Yes, so locally of C1 and C2 respectively, okay? Okay, so you have the following, we have the following exact sequence. This is the non-zero element in C goes to xc tilde os c tilde. So what do you do in S? So this is only at the point S. You take the two valuations and then you map it to z times z o. So a function here, you take the evaluation of the function. Mm-hmm. And these are integers. So for instance, if the evaluation in F of F at the point S is zero, that means that you have no zeros or no poles. You have negatives, you have a pole of this with this multiplicity, I mean with this order. And the quotient is can be identified with the kernel, because you have F in the kernel of these evaluations, if only if the evaluations at the point are zero, both of them. So as you said, no zeros and no poles of F at both points, at S1 and S2. Mm-hmm. So you can associate it to this a complex number name. So in S1, F in S1, F in S2. Mm-hmm. This is what. So in conclusion, you should not be scared of this. Local description, because it's a nicest way of describing. After you choosing parametrization, T1, T2, local parameters around the points S1 and S2. So these points are over my node. So you can identify is isomorphic to Ctilda Z. Okay, so a point here. So yes, you have a function here. So a term of a function, it can be written as a this parameter. Until, so you have two different points, and then you send it to U, V, M, N. Those M and N are integers. This is N. Mm-hmm. Okay. So conclusion. In overall node, you can describe the Cartier divisors as a distribute. Okay. And we are assuming, and I can tell you exactly how does he act iota in this node by the following formula. Zmn at the point S is -1 m plus n Zmn. So it doesn't change the order of the m and n, that the branches doesn't change, it's just change the -1 on the plus or -1 on Z depending on m and n. Okay, so you have, as usual, some sort of diagram. So you have the Cartier divisors. To each Cartier divisor, you can associate a line bundle on C tilde. And you can go to with the norm map. Mm-hmm. Here you take the push forward of the Cartier divisors. So on the part where smooth is clear, when the part is not smooth, you can use this formula. This is a norm map, also for extensions. Okay. Mm-hmm. So let me tell you exactly what it is. So on the smooth ones, it's just to push forward. And over the nodes is -1 plus n. You take the square of this, and that's all. At the node downstairs. Mm-hmm. Okay, let me have a little time. When I should finish now, right? Yeah.
Mm. Yep.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I had to be more. Okay. Well, just to conclude, my plan is to give you an idea of what happens on the boundary. look, I know I'm not going to do all the details, but at least, you know, I will show you next time some examples of allowable covers. So what will be an allowable cover will be something such that the kernel map, the kernel of the norm map is an abelian variety. That's what they want. Yeah. And I will tell you exactly which the allowable covers are, I mean, how they construct. They will give you some simple examples, and I need to know them in order to compute this local degree. But it's like an excuse, this computational local degree is an excuse to have a look at the boundary and understand all these constructions, yeah, on the nodes. This is it's fascinating, but it's technical as well. So yeah. Okay, questions?
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
So in the like in the middle of the presentation, you mentioned a lemma, this cotangent map of PG.
Yes.
It's a surjective for genus at least six.
Yes.
Is that a surjective or generically surjective?
Generical is as a surjective for the generic point is what they need.
Oh, okay. So you're talking about generic. Okay.
At the generic point, yes.
Okay, that's my question.
Yes, and then that will mean that is generically finite, the map.
In other words, sometimes, for example, genus 6 case, it can have some positive dimensional fiber.
Exactly. Yes, okay. And we will see them then in the computation. Yes. So because this computations degree, I will do it. I will tell you now. I will do the computation of the Jacobian of a genus 5 curve. This is a principally polarized abelian variety. And I will look at the fiber of this generic Jacobian. And the fiber is not finite. This is the beauty of the thing, that they compute the local degree over a fiber that is actually not finite. But then they do the BOP. And I find it beautiful that you understand many things. I mean, something that looks abstract, you know, what is the blob? They can give you exactly what does it mean, the normal bundle, what all in geometric terms. So there is a full description of what is the blob, what is the local degree at this blob, and they can make the count, precise count, just by looking at the geometry of those objects. So that's the beauty. So. Yeah, I mean, it's hard work, but it's rewarding. Yes.
Okay. Yes. Thank you.
Yeah.
So, okay. Sorry, Angela. So, in this P6 map, is in this case the contracted locus completely understood or no?
No. The contracted locus. You mean?
So, where the map is not in finite.
For that case, that's a good question. I don't think so. There are many loci that is very well understood. The cubic trifolds, for instance. But I don't think it's known that, okay, that is, I don't think so, no. I will have a look at that, but I, no.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
And for higher genus, are there any conjectures about the injectivity locus?
No, I don't know. Herbert Lange and Isadi Elham, you can ask Elham. they have a nice paper on the. They show many examples that they are not coming from the tetragonal construction for any genus, and I think any Clifford index. So there are examples of, you know, it's a very, very general type of examples in any genus where it's not generically finite. So that contradicts original conjectures. Originally, people conjecture that all the non-injectivity locus come from the tetragonal construction, but it's not the case. This is not true. It's not true. So we don't know. I don't know. I haven't heard any particular conjecture. It's really mysterious. Yeah. I mean, if you can put your hands on low genus, it would be nice, yes. But no.
Okay, thanks.
More questions? Okay, so see you tomorrow then. Or see you at what, 4:40 for the picture?
4:50.
Okay.
For see the you. Photo. Remember, okay. Everyone, we have the group photo today.
Okay. 4:50.
And
okay.
Now we say goodbye to Angela and thank you. And we move over for half an hour on Gather. And then we will be back here.